Hello learners, welcome back to my channel Shraddha's Physics. In this lecture we will see the magnetic properties of the matter, and in this part we will discuss the diamagnetic, paramagnetic, ferri and ferromagnetic materials. First of all we will see the difference between this ferromagnetic, ferri, para and diamagnetic materials, and that after we will discuss about this type of the magnetic substances. Now let us start with the diamagnet, paramagnet and ferromagnetic material. So in case of the diamagnetic material, these substances, they are feebly repelled by the magnet. So this is the property of the diamagnetic substance, that they will be repelled, and this repulsion power is very small because of this diamagnetic material, and we will discuss it why this diamagnetic substance is feebly repelled by the magnet, we will discuss. And in case of the paramagnetic material, it has the property that it is feebly attracted by the magnet. In case of the paramagnetic material, the attraction occurs, but here this is feebly attracted by the magnet. And in case of the ferromagnetic substance, they are strongly attracted by the magnet. So this is the basic difference between dia, para and ferro. In case of para and ferro, they both attract both substances are attracted by the magnet, but in case of the paramagnetic material, they are feebly attracted by the magnet, but in case of the ferromagnetic material, they are strongly attracted by the magnet. But in case of the diamagnetic material, it is feebly repelled by the magnet. Then the next, when this diamagnetic material, it is placed in a magnetic field, it acquires feebly magnetism and opposite to the direction of the field. So here, if the diamagnetic material, it is placed in a magnetic field, then inside this diamagnetic material, so an opposite magnetic field, or that is known as the induced magnetic field, is developed. That is, it is in the opposite direction to that of the external field. And in case of the paramagnetic material, when it is placed in a magnetic field, it acquires feeble magnetism in the direction of the magnetic field. But in case of the paramagnetic material, if you place a paramagnetic material in the external magnetic field, so in that case, inside this paramagnetic material, the magnetic field developed, it will align themselves in the direction of the magnetic field. That is applied magnetic field. And in case of this ferromagnetic matter, if you place a ferromagnetic substance in the external magnetic field, then inside this ferromagnetic matter, the magnetic field develop, that is, they will lie in the direction of this magnetic field. And if you remove this external field, that after also this magnetic field retain inside this ferromagnetic matter, so we can say that it has been strongly magnetized. So this ferromagnetic material is a strong magnet. Then next, when placed in the magnetic field, that is the diamagnetic substance, when placed in a magnetic field, the lines of force, they tend to avoid the substance. Okay. So now you can see, if this is a magnetic, suppose your diamagnetic substance is placed here. So now if you apply some external field, then they will just try to avoid this magnetic substance. Okay, so the direction of the field is just like this. But in case of the paramagnetic substance, the lines of force, it prefer to pass through the substance rather than air. So if you place a paramagnetic substance and you apply some external field, that is the magnetic field, then what will happen? Some of the magnetic field, they will enter through this paramagnetic substance. And in case of the ferromagnetic substance, if you place a ferromagnetic substance in the external external magnetic field, then the lines of force, they will try to, although that is the maximum lines of force, they will try to enter through this ferromagnetic substance. In case of the diamagnetic substance, they will try to just repel, or you can say that they will try to avoid the substance. But in case of the paramagnetic material, some of the lines, they will try to, the lines of force, they will try to pass through the paramagnetic material. And in case of the ferromagnetic material, the maximum lines of force, they will try to enter through this ferromagnetic substance. This is the basic difference between dia, para and ferro. Now also see, in case of the magnetic moment, there is no permanent dipole moment or magnetic moment in each atom. That is, in case of the diamagnetic material, there will be no permanent dipole moment or the magnetic moment. In case of the diamagnetic material, the magnetic moment, if I'll study about the magnetic moment, So there will be no permanent dipole moment or the magnetic moment in each atom. But in case of the paramagnetic metal, there is permanent dipole moment or the magnetic moment in each atom. And in case of the ferromagnetic metal, there will be enormous permanent dipole moment or the magnetic moment in each atom. So it means that in case of the diamagnetic metal, there will be no permanent dipole moment. And in case of the paramagnetic metal, there will be permanent dipole moment. And in case of the ferromagnetic metal, there will be maximum or the last number of permanent dipole moment. Now the next. For the diamagnetic metal, it has no spin. In case of the paramagnetic metal, all the spins are randomly oriented. And in case of the ferromagnetic metal, the spin alignment is in the parallel in the same direction. Okay. The spin alignment is parallel and it is in the same direction. The next, if we'll discuss about the susceptibility and its temperature dependence property. So susceptibility means this is just symbolized by your chi. This is your chi symbol. This is your susceptibility. So susceptibility is always negative in case of the diamagnetic material. The susceptibility its meaning is basically susceptibility. It gives the whether the material is attracted into or repelled out of the magnetic field. So the susceptibility indicates whether the material is attracted into or repelled out of the magnetic field. So it is negative means. So the repulsion is in case of the diamagnetic metal, and here you can see the susceptibility is positive in case of the paramagnetic metal, and it is also positive in case of the ferromagnetic metal. So it means that they will be attracted in the case of the para and ferromagnetic metal, and in case of the diamagnetic metal, it will be repelled by the magnet. And next, the temperature. It is independent of the temperature and the strength of the applied magnetic field. So the diamagnetic metal will not depend on the temperature and the strength of the magnetic field. And here the susceptibility is small because the attraction for the case of the paramagnetic metal, it is small. And in case of the ferromagnetic metal, susceptibility is positive and it is very less. It means that in case of the ferromagnetic metal, it will be strongly attracted by the magnetic substance or the strongly attracted by the magnet. And here it is inversely proportional to, in case of the paramagnetic metal, it is inversely proportional to the absolute temperature. That is, susceptibility is inversely proportional to the temperature, or you can write susceptibility equal to C by T. Here C is the constant and that is known as the Curie's constant. And in case of the ferromagnetic metal, this chi susceptibility equal to C by T minus theta. This is known as the Curie-Weiss law. We'll discuss on this topic. And when T greater than theta, so the paramagnetic behavior occurs. And when T is less than theta, then the ferromagnetic behavior occurs. That is, you can see when this T very very larger than theta, so this value tends to C by T. So which will leads to the paramagnetic material. So the next, if we'll see the behavior of the material in the presence of the magnetic field, as we have discussed, if we place a diamagnetic metal, then the magnetic field will try to repel. This is the magnetic field direction, you can see. When the metal is placed in the magnetic field, the magnetic lines of force there repelled away from the material. Okay, so here you can see the B out will be greater than the B input. B in, that is inside the magnetic material. So this will be, it is less than that of the out or the external magnetic field. B out or the external magnetic field. And in case of the paramagnetic metal, the magnetic lines of force, these are attracted towards the center of the metal, or you may draw the lines of force like this. And in case of the ferromagnetic metal, they are highly attracted towards the center of the metal. So here you can see the maximum magnetic field is present here, that is inside the magnetic material. This will be very very larger than that of the external or the outer, or this is basically the external field or the outside part of the magnetic material. So the magnetic lines of force present inside the metal will be more in case of the ferromagnetic metal, and in that is very very larger, okay, very very larger than B out. So here in case of the paramagnetic metal, so this B in is greater than B out. But in case of the diamagnetic metal, so here you can say, since here the repulsion occurs, so here B out will be greater than B in. Then the next, relative magnetic permeability, that is mu r. In case of this diamagnetic metal, mu r is slightly less than 1. It means that this permeability, it is the degree of magnetization that a material obtains in response to an applied magnetic field. So this is the degree of magnetization. It is slightly less than 1 in case of the diamagnetic metal, and it is greater than 1 in case of the paramagnetic metal, and it is very much greater than 1 in case of the ferromagnetic metal. The example of diamagnetic metals are the hydrogen, bismuth, antimony, gold, superconducting metals like niobium, etc. And the paramagnetic metal examples are aluminium, platinum, sodium, titanium, zirconium, chromium, etc. And the ferromagnetic metal are iron, nickel, cobalt, etc. Now, if you will see the difference between the ferromagnetic metal, antiferromagnetic metal, and ferrimagnetic metal, you can see all the magnetic dipoles, they are aligned parallel and oriented in the same direction in case of the ferromagnetic metal. And this parallel alignment of the atomic magnetic dipole, it occurs only in the microscopic region, and it is called the magnetic domain. We'll discuss more on this magnetic domain later. So basically you can see that in case of the ferromagnetic metal, they all align in the parallel direction, and or we can say that in the same direction. So this parallel alignment of the atomic magnetic dipole occurs only in the magnetic domain. And in case of the antiferromagnetic material, here the successive magnetic dipoles are aligned in the opposite direction. Okay, they align in the same direction, but in case of the antiferromagnetic metal, they will align in the opposite direction. And in case of the ferrimagnetic material, the successive magnetic moments are of different magnitude, they are aligned in the opposite direction. That is, here the magnetic moments are of different magnitude, they will align in the opposite direction only. And the next, in case of the ferromagnetic metal, the net magnetization is zero if the domains are randomly oriented. And in case of the antiferromagnetic metal, at room temperature, manganese and chromium in the solid state, it exhibit antiferromagnetism. And the ratio of this, and in case of the ferrimagnetic material, a large magnetization is produced on applying a small magnetic field. Okay. And here, the magnetic dipoles of the iron, cobalt, and nickel, they are arranged parallel due to the creation of the positive exchange of energy between them. And in case of the antiferromagnetic material, the susceptibility is very small and positive. And the susceptibility, it increases with the increasing temperature and reaches to a maximum value of one particular temperature called the Neel temperature. And above this Neel temperature, the antiferromagnetic material, it becomes the paramagnetic material. So basically, in case of the antiferromagnetic material, you can see the susceptibility is positive. Susceptibility positive means this will be get attracted by the magnet, and the, it increases with the increasing temperature. That is, when you increase the temperature, the susceptibility will increases, and it reaches the maximum value. Since it is an antiferromagnetic metal, you know, chi equal to C by T minus theta. This is in case of the ferromagnetic material. But here in case of this antiferromagnetic metal, this is just opposite to that. That is, if you increase this temperature, this susceptibility increases, and it will reach at a maximum value of one particular temperature, and that is known as the Neel temperature in case of the antiferromagnetic metal. Okay. So above this Neel temperature, this antiferromagnetic metal, they will behave like a paramagnetic metal. And similarly, you can see here, in case of the ferrimagnetic metal, so in case of this ferrimagnetic metal, they are used in the high frequency applications. The example of this, you can see, here you can see the ferromagnetic metals are heated when it loses its magnetism slowly. And the example of this antiferromagnetic material are ferrous oxide, manganese oxide, zinc ferrite, etc. And the example of ferrimagnetic materials are ferrous ferrite, nickel ferrite, manganese ferrite, etc. So these are the basic difference between diapara ferro and ferromagnetic material, ferrimagnetic material, and antiferromagnetic material. Now let us start with our diamagnetic substance and From this comparison or the from where we have distinguished between this diamagnetic and paramagnetic and ferromagnetic metal, from that we already know that the substances which when placed in a magnetic field are weakly magnetized in a direction opposite to that of the applied field. They are known as the diamagnetic metal. They will be magnetized in the opposite direction to that of the applied field. So here the examples of the diamagnetic material are, just a minute, the examples are the bismuth, copper, zinc, gold, water, etc. Here you can see, since the weak induced magnetic field is in a direction opposite to that of the applied field, the resultant magnetic field in the diamagnetic substance is slightly less than the external field. So the magnetic susceptibility of the diamagnetic substance is negative. We'll discuss on that. So let us consider, suppose here, let us consider this is a diamagnetic substance, any diamagnetic substance when it is placed. Suppose here, this is in the absence, no external field is given here. Here suppose the magnetic field is zero. So when this external magnetic field is zero, so in this case the atoms, or you can say the molecules or the ions of this diamagnetic substance, they have no net magnetic moment. So magnetic moment is zero. Magnetic moment equal to zero in this case. So the substance, it doesn't exhibit diamagnetism. So that is, in case of magnetic field is zero, or in case of the absence of the external field, the atoms or molecules or the ions, in the absence of the external magnetic field, the atoms, molecules or ions of the diamagnetic substance, they have no net magnetic moment. So the substance doesn't exhibit diamagnetism. And when this diamagnetic substance, when it is placed in a, suppose this diamagnetic substance now placed in a magnetic field, or if I will apply some magnetic field to this diamagnetic metal, then what will happen? So because you know the Faraday's law, because of this Faraday's law, the current will be induced in this, that is, this current that will induced in through this diamagnetic metal, it will try to oppose this applied magnetic field. So because of that reason, according to the Lenz's law, this current, that is this opposing current, it will try to give a magnetic field, and that is known as the induced magnetic field, and that will be just opposite direction to that of the applied magnetic field. So here you can see, when this diamagnetic substance, it is placed in an external magnetic field, the currents are induced in the current loops of atoms, molecules or ion according to the Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. That is, because of this external magnetic field that we are applying to this diamagnetic substance, a current will be induced. Because of this Faraday's law, according to this Faraday's law, a current will be induced because of this magnetic field, and it will try to oppose that magnetic field. And according to the Lenz's law, this current will give rise to another magnetic field which will try to oppose the applied magnetic field. Hence, these induced magnetic moments of the atoms or molecules or ions, they are directed opposite to that of the applied magnetic field. So this results in a weak repulsive force on the substance. Now you can see here this is your diamagnetic substance when no magnetic field is applied here. So these are your, suppose, atoms or the molecules or ions present inside this diamagnetic substance. But when you apply some magnetic field to this magnetic material, so you can see here, in this diamagnetic substance, inside this diamagnetic substance, the atoms or molecules or ions present in this diamagnetic substance, there will be some magnetic moment, the magnetic moments will induced in this, and the net magnetic field here, you can see the magnetic field developed here, it is just the opposite direction to that of the field applied. So the individual atoms of the diamagnetic material, they do not possess a permanent magnetic moment. That is, if you remove this magnetic field, then again the magnetic moment will be zero. When an external magnetic field is applied, the atoms acquire a small induced magnetic moment in a direction opposite to that of the direction of the applied field, and the strength of the induced magnetic moment, it is directly proportional to the applied field. And the induced dipoles and magnetization, it vanishes as soon as the applied magnetic field is removed. When this magnetic field will be removed, then this dipole and its magnetization, that is the dipole moment, it will vanishes. And hence, this dimagnetism is a property of all the atoms because of the influence of an applied magnetic field on the motion of the electrons in their orbit. So, since the electrons are orbiting around this nucleus, so because of this motion of the electron, so a magnetic field will develop, and that applied magnetic, so we can say that this is the dimagnetic property of the atoms. So how you distinguish between a paramagnetic metal and a dimagnetic metal? So to distinguish between a dimagnetic metal and a dimagnetic metal and a paramagnetic metal, dia and para, so the basic difference between these two is, if the number of electrons present, in an atom, it is even in nature, so that is called the dimagnetic metal. When the number of electrons present in an atom, this is odd, then that atom is called the paramagnetic metal, or this is your paramagnetic atom. So if you'll consider, suppose let us take some example. Suppose in case of the nitrogen, if we'll take nitrogen N2, so here there are, the nitrogen molecule has 7 plus 7, that will be total 14 number of electrons, and this 14 is your even. So this is no doubt, this is a dimagnetic metal. Okay. But if you will take N2 minus, that is an ion. So in this case, this will be 14 plus 1. So that is extra electron is present here. So that will be, there will be 15 number of electrons are present. So since this 15 is an odd number, it is an odd number. So this is your paramagnetic metal. Okay. Similarly, if you will say this is N2 2 minus, if we'll take, this is suppose N2 2 minus. So here there will be 14 plus 2. So there are 2 extra electrons. So there will be 16 number of electrons since it is even. Again, this is your dimagnetic metal. If we'll take O2 plus, then O2 plus means, O means there will be 16. But here because of this plus, there will be minus 1. So there will be 15 electrons are present since it is odd. So here you can say this is your paramagnetic material. Okay. So in this way you can distinguish between the dimagnetic and paramagnetic material according to the number of electrons present in an atom. Now let us see the paramagnetism, ferromagnetism and the diamagnetism. So let us consider this first figure suppose. So it shows that a current loop and the magnetic field lines, it is associated with a magnetic material. So the dipole moment mu equal to I into A, this is also shown here, you can see. The magnetic field at the center of the dipole, it is in the direction of the mu. So the direction of the dipole moment and the magnetic field, they will be in the same direction. The behavior is opposite to that in case of an electric dipole. But if you will consider for the electric dipole, the electric field at the center of an electric dipole, it is just opposite to the that of the dipole moment. That is, if we will distinguish between an electric dipole and a magnetic dipole, here you can see this is suppose a magnet is present, having its north pole and south pole is present. Suppose like this. So here you can see the magnetic moment and the magnetic field at the center, they will be in the same direction. But if we'll consider an electric dipole, that is having a positive charge and the negative charge here. So here the dipole direction and the dipole moment, electric dipole moment and the electric field direction, they will be just in the opposite direction. That is the dipole moment direction, if this is downward, and the electric field will be just opposite to that, that is in the upward direction. So it means that when a magnetic field aligns the atomic dipole in its direction, the magnetized material, it produces an extra magnetic field in the material in the direction of the applied field. So the magnetic field will be developed in the direction of the applied field. So this resultant magnetic field in the material is then greater than that of the applied field. This tendency, it will try to increase the magnetic field due to the magnetization of the material, and that is called the paramagnetism. And the material which exhibit this type of property, that is called the paramagnetic material. That is, suppose in case of paramagnetic metal, if you consider, suppose this is a paramagnetic material, so if we give a external magnetic field to this paramagnetic metal, then the atomic poles, that is the atomic dipoles present in this paramagnetic metal, they will try to tend themselves, align, they will try to align themselves in the direction of the field, so that the applied field will now increases. So here you can see the same thing is written here. So the tendency to increase this magnetic field due to this magnetization of the metal, that is called the paramagnetism. So here in this case, in the case of the paramagnetic material, the atomic dipole, they will try to align themselves in the direction of the magnetic field. So the magnetized material produces an extra magnetic field in that material. Okay. So in the same metal, in some materials, the permanent atomic magnetic moments have strong tendency to align themselves even without any external field. So these materials are called the ferromagnetic material. So the permanent magnets are made from the force between the neighboring atoms. They are responsible for their alignment, and that is called exchange coupling. So if you consider a ferromagnetic metal, suppose here it is a ferromagnetic metal. So in some part, so there will be some atoms present. Suppose at this point there are some atoms are present here. So this the atoms present in this part, they have suppose the direction every atoms there. Suppose in this part, the dipole moment of the atoms, all the atoms there, suppose in this direction. And if we'll consider any other part here, in this ferromagnetic metal, suppose the alignment is in this direction for every atoms present in that particular part. And again, if I'll consider any other part, suppose the dipole moment, net dipole moment is in this direction. And similarly, if I'll consider any part of this ferromagnetic metal, they will be in the random direction. The magnetic moment, they will be in the random direction, or the atomic dipole moment, here you can see, they will be in the random direction. So this individual, so just like this, any other direction, any possible direction, that is your random direction there. Okay, just like this. So this particular area, any of this particular area, that is called as the magnetic domain. This particular area, it is called one domain. Any particular, this part is your magnetic domain. So here you can see the atoms in any domain, it has the magnetic moments in the same direction. So in this part, the magnetic moments, that is the atoms present in this part, they have the same direction, magnetic moment has the same direction. So it gives a net magnetic moment to the domain. So the different domains, however, have different direction of the magnetic moment, and hence the material remains all magnetized, because since they are of random direction, so they are randomly magnetized. Since they are randomly magnetized, so you can say that the net magnetic field in case of this ferromagnetic metal is zero, the net magnetic metal. But if you will consider the individual domain, so in case of the individual domain, there will be the magnetic moment, but as a whole, for the total system, there will be the zero magnetic moment. So the metal remains unmagnetized. So different domains have different sizes, and the sizes may be less as a millimeter in linear dimension. Now, if a magnetic field is applied to this ferromagnetic material, the domains which are aligned along the direction of the field, they will grow in size, and those opposite to it, it get reduced. Suppose if I'll consider this figure, so let us see this figure. Suppose there are four domains in a ferromagnetic substance. So here the alignment is like this, and here the alignment is in the upward direction, here the direction, and here the direction of the magnetic moment. Now if you'll apply some magnetic field in this direction, if you'll apply some magnetic field that is in the upward direction, then you can see only this domain, it is in this upward direction. So this part, this domain, you can say, which are aligned in this particular direction of this field, it will grow. This domain will grow. You can see this part will grow. Now this other part, the other three domain, it will get reduced. This happens because the walls of the domains, they will move across the sample, and also the domains may orient themselves in favor of the applied field. So because of this domain character of the ferromagnetic material, Even if a small magnetic field is applied, it gives rise to a large magnetization. So the resultant field is much larger than the applied field in such a material. Now suppose the individual atoms of a material, they do not have a net magnetic dipole moment. When such a substance is placed in a magnetic field, the dipole moments are induced in the atoms by the applied field. And from this Lenz's law, the magnetic field due to this induced magnetic moment, it will try to oppose the original field. So that is, the Lenz's law says, it will try to oppose to that very cause for which it is produced. So due to the induced magnetic moment, it opposes the original field. So the resultant field in such a material is therefore smaller than that of the applied field. So this phenomenon is called the dimagnetism, and such materials are called the dimagnetic material. So the conclusion is that the magnetic moments are induced in all the materials whenever a magnetic field is applied. So all the materials have the property of the dimagnetism. However, if there is a permanent atomic magnetic moment, then paramagnetic or ferromagnetic is more strong. So all the materials are, so let us just a minute. However, if there is a permanent atomic magnetic moment, so in that case paramagnetic metal or the ferromagnetic metal is formed. And here you should note that this paramagnetic metal and the ferromagnetic metal, it is more stronger than the dimagnetic metal, and they doesn't show the dimagnetic properties. That is, this paramagnetic metal and the ferromagnetic metal, they will not show the dimagnetic properties. Since this paramagnetic and ferromagnetic metal has the property to attract, this paramagnetic and ferromagnetic metal, they will attracted by the magnet. But the dimagnetic metal, they are feebly repelled by a magnet. Okay, so in case of the dimagnetic metal, they are since feebly repelled by the magnet. So these are the paramagnetic metal and the ferromagnetic metal, they will not show the dimagnetic properties. Now we will see the ferrimagnetism. So the ferrite exhibits a type of magnetism known as the ferrimagnetism. The ferrimagnetic metals, they doesn't lose its magnetism even in the absence of the external magnetic field. That is, if you remove this external field, they will not lose its magnetic property. So in the ferrimagnetic metal, the atoms have opposing magnetic moments or the magnetic field strength, but these opposing magnetic moments are unequal. Now you can see these are unequal in nature. So here this one is the black one and red one, you can see the difference between these. You can see here in this diagram, this one is the larger one and here is the smaller one, the larger one and the smaller one. So here you can see the distinguish between these two. So in the ferrimagnetic metal, atoms having opposing magnetic moments or the magnetic field strength, but these opposing magnetic moments are unequal in nature. So there exists some net magnetic moment. So the magnetic moment direction is this. So the example of this ferrimagnetic metal are the iron oxides, aluminium, cobalt, nickel, zinc, ferrites, etc. That is aluminium ferrite, cobalt ferrite, nickel ferrite, zinc ferrite, etc. That is basically the ferrite. The ferrite exhibits the type of magnetism that is known as your ferrimagnetism. And its properties are, they have high resistivity and anisotropic properties, and it has directional property. So it is used in construction of the microwave devices like isolators, circulators and gyrators. Okay, so this is all about your dimagnetic, paramagnetic and ferromagnetic material. And your also we have already discussed, that is your antiferromagnetic material and ferrimagnetic material. And this is all for today. Thank you.